Commonwealth of the United States.
Mr. Rush, you and I will fall down to the road leading to the Federal City near the Georgetown Path. I'm dispatching James Smith immediately to alert Mrs. Madison that she must evacuate the President's house immediately. It is now evident that the British intention is to invade the Federal City.
What is it, sir? I have not seen you so exercised since you were delayed and you had your last disagreement.
Success, sir. Success.
Success at what, sir?
Meeting the English at their own game, that's all.
Sir, make yourself clear. What game? The English have many games.
At war. We. I have just received word from Senator Meyer. Just received word in files, Senator Meyer. Told him he is now off looking for the play and wherever he is at this time of day.
I was saying then, sir, that there is a victory, but where?
Plattsburgh, New York, Lake Champlain. On September 11th, the English joined the occupation force already here. On a combined attack to take the three forts. The soldiers in that occupation force were released from New York after holding that occupation. Their command there, the naval commander, Captain Downing, was new to the war with many experienced crews.
Now is the time when England will finally cease seeing us as some recalcitrant and rebellious daughter who by beatings and inducements can be led to fall into the arms of her loving mother, England. Now is the time that England, having come to an equal peace with us, will lead the other nations in Europe to see us in the same light as an equal in the arms of the nations. Now is the time when we have secured, finally, our revolution, and we will be able to pursue that which we have been seeking, peace and security, but with the knowledge that we can, we will, and we must secure our independence. Now is the time.
Now I have the pleasure of speaking with Ronald Duquette, one of the authors and cast members of the play From Plattsburgh to Peace. And the burning question, Mr. Duquette, why pick one particular incident within the War of 1812 to focus on for the play? Now, coming from New York State myself, I know the Battle of Plattsburgh was very poorly covered in our New York State history classes mm-hmm. in school, mm-hmm. and even at the college level when discussing that in American history classes.
Well, in the first instance, when we speak at all about the War of 1812, it's a forgotten war. It's not unlike the war in Korea from 1950 to 53. It is said that you learn more from your defeats than from your victories. And I would agree with that. But the question about the War of 1812 is, was it a defeat, was it a victory, or was it a stalemate? And I would argue that actually learning about this stalemate is of great importance for us, because the likelihood of an outright victory becomes less and less apparent in the way that the world is working these days. And I say that as a former soldier myself. And so if you're going to try to encapsulate the totality of a war in one or two or three scenes, you have to sort of go to the critical point at which the balance tips in one direction or another. The original play that I had written, rather unusually in a two-hour burst of energy, consisted of three scenes. And the three scenes were President Madison after the burning of the Federal City, looking out on the burnt hulk of the executive mansion and bemoaning his circumstances, that this just was not what he had hoped would be the case. The second scene was primarily between Vince Pugliafico, who portrayed John Quincy Adams, and myself, and it was with the information that we received in early November of 1814 that Plattsburgh had occurred, and that suddenly this seemed to have convinced the English that it was time to treat seriously. The last scene was again back to Madison in the Octagon House in the Federal City, receiving the treaty and preparing to sign it, thus bringing about an end to the war. At the time that we did this, presented this in Plattsburgh in 2016. I'm trying to keep all the dates straight here. 2016, and it was extremely well received. We had no idea how many people would show. We had no idea how many people even knew anything enough about the play to do anything, and yet over 60 people showed and stayed for the question and answer afterwards, which then brought to our mind that it was probably a very good idea to expand the play and thus to provide yet more of a background to why Plattsburgh was so important. It was not a denial of the importance of Baltimore and the victory that we gained in Baltimore, but it was a defensive victory. Or the Battle of New Orleans, which, while an outright victory, was nonetheless a battle that took place after the treaty had been signed. And its only possible effect could have been a negative one. If we had lost that battle, we might have had to reopen the negotiations with the English, because we had yet to ratify the treaty on our end of the arrangement. So when I had decided that we needed to combine somehow James Madison, which was Kyle Jenks, and Mr. Pugliafico as John Quincy Adams, and who has known in the Plattsburgh area as somebody who, in fact, can talk to the Battle of Plattsburgh and the War of 1812, and myself as Albert Gallatin, the initial thought was, what is the most important single event that tips the balance? And my conclusion was, and agreed to by my colleagues, that the Battle of Plattsburgh was the one that we had to know and we had to discuss to some extent for people to understand how this essentially forgotten battle. Nobody remembers anything except the Battle of New Orleans. They might know about the Constitution versus the Guerrière, the naval battle which sort of opened the war.
And most school kids know about Fort McHenry because
right.
of the
Star-Spangled Banner and so on and so forth. But in specific terms, when you take a look at things at the totality of the war, up until 1814, matters were going very much against the United States. Not so much at sea, but by 1814, our ships were basically blockaded into port. Militarily, we were doing better by 1814. We had not done well in the first year and a half of the war. Lundy's Lane was a significant victory, with Winfield Scott as the preeminent military figure to come out of those particular battles. But when you come to the strategic issues, four invasions, one into northern Maine, which seized that half of the county of Maine, as it was known at the time, in order to build a road, strategic road between Halifax and Quebec and Montreal. The second invasion was, of course, the attack on the federal city and then eventually Baltimore. The third was the traditional invasion route down Lake Champlain to try to split the northern states off. The English were figuring that at that point, if they were successful in doing so, the northern states would adhere to England, would end up
becoming... But by that point, we also held Fort Ticonderoga, which is right on Lake Champlain.
That they never got down that far.
Okay, they only, that's right. Plattsburgh is a bit.
Yeah, they only got down to Plattsburgh. They turned around after their defeat at the Battle of Lake Champlain. It's called the Battle of Plattsburgh. It should really be called the Battle of Lake Champlain, because it was the naval battle that determined what was going to happen there. Lieutenant General Edward Prevost, who was the commander of a 10,000-man force that had come down from British Canada into New York, was not prepared to move farther south until the Navy, his Navy, four ships and attendant other smaller boats, had successfully routed the Americans out of Plattsburgh Bay. He needed to have a clear passageway going southward. And so when Prevost arrives in Plattsburgh and there are four American ships that are anchored in Plattsburgh Bay, obviously in a position where you're going to have to go through us in order to be able to continue your invasion. Excuse me. The naval battle was a foregone conclusion that had to occur. The advantages that the Americans had was they knew where they were. They had also prepared the cabling system so as to be able to capstan the ships around 180 degrees. And even though one side might have been badly battered, they would be able to present an essentially fresh broadside against the English ships, which could not get around them, and which, in trying to turn their position to present a fresh broadside, it would be too difficult. And in the first 15 minutes of the battle, the English commander was killed. And so they were without a central direction. And when the four ships of the English fleet were defeated, Prevost realized he could not continue that particular effort. What we didn't know at Ghent after the Battle of Plattsburgh, and would not know for a number of years afterwards, was that in spite of the fact that Baltimore was a defeat, it was a repulse, really, and it had cost them. It had cost them the life of General Robert Ross, who was the military commander under the overall command of Admiral Cockburn. The burning of the Federal City, the repulse at Baltimore were absolutely important. I mean, I don't wish to downplay their part in what ultimately occurred in Ghent. But the truth of the matter is that after Plattsburgh, the British cabinet begins to start asking itself some serious questions. And they were enormously embarrassed by the loss at Plattsburgh, and particularly with Prevost turning tail and going back to Canada. And when they offered in November, early November of 1814, the North American command to the Duke of Wellington, the Iron Duke, in essence, said, "Yes, I'll go if you want me to. However, you've got to understand, folks, this is not going to be a war of conquest. You cannot conquer America. You cannot provide enough troops to conquer America." And that's when the cabinet took a deep breath, realized that its most senior and most successful soldier was essentially counseling them, go to the negotiation table, start treating this. That's why I say that Plattsburgh is the tipping point. It's the one that convinces the British cabinet, we just can't make a go of this anymore. The merchants are screaming at us. We have the possibility of returning to war on the European continent. Napoleon is unhappily and uneasily over in Elba. We don't know how that's all going to turn out. Louis XVIII Bourbon is not doing a good job of taking control in France. And so there are a whole series of issues which gather, and finally the cabinet decides it is time to cut our losses and just simply concede we can't win the war and we can't lose the war. And the chances are, if we keep on trying, there's a stronger chance of losing it than winning it. So we'll just take a stalemate. And that's exactly what they did. They took the stalemate. But the stalemate for us was particularly important because even after we had gained our independence in 1783 by the Treaty of Paris, we were still, in essence, trying to fight the British every step of the way. We'd fight them economically, we would fight them militarily, not so much in actual combat, but they would not relinquish the frontier posts until eventually they were forced to it. And when you start looking at the impressment of our sailors and the various economic activities that England entered into, France as well, but England being the mistress of the seas, especially after Trafalgar, there's no question. It was the English who were the primary culprits of our economic and political malaise. For England to basically say, all right, enough is enough, we're going to let the United States go, it was the confirmation not only of our place in the Concert of Nations, but it was also the confirmation of our revolution's independence. We had finally secured it, no matter what.
We were a nation.
We were a nation.
And to be reckoned with.
Exactly. And that was precisely what Madison, Monroe, and Gallatin were all after. Monroe as Secretary of State. Immediately after the treaty had been signed on Christmas Eve, the next day, Gallatin sat down and wrote a letter to James Monroe, who, as the Secretary of State, was waiting rather anxiously for what news would come. And Gallatin says, in essence, you know, this is about as good a treaty as we're going to get. We didn't gain anything, but we lost nothing. And the hope that this would be the last time that we would contest our independence with England was what motivated all of them that were there at Ghent on the Second American Commission. John Quincy Adams, Gallatin, Senator James Bayard, Henry Clay, and Jonathan Russell.
And so after that, there were things that in the Jay Treaty had been set for a certain period. So we did have to go back to the negotiating table with England to finalize some of that, correct?
Well, no. Actually, what the Jay Treaty had, insofar as trade agreements were concerned, yes, we were in fact sent, Adams, Clay, and myself, as Gallatin, were sent to London to pursue a trade agreement with England. And it's sort of remarkable that after 2.5 years of war, that the next thing they do is they go to London in January and they begin to negotiate a trade agreement with England to try to improve America's position and at the same time to give the English a chance to be able to trade with us. What the Jay Treaty is actually two parts. One was the attempt to treat with the English about impressment in 1795. That came to nothing. The treaty with Spain in 1795, which opened the Mississippi up for 3 years, and then while they could continue to operate the Mississippi, so to speak, it required a 6-month notification for the cancellation of the treaty. And then what we later found out, the Jefferson administration found out that there had been a secret treaty, a secret clause to a treaty, the Third Treaty of San Ildefonso, between Spain and France. And that was where Spain retroceded the Louisiana territory back to France, which it had gained in 1763 as part of that Treaty of Paris. There's several treaties of Paris you have to keep in mind.
It seemed to be a popular place for treaties.
It was a good place to go, I mean, for a number of reasons.
Nice city.
And lots of lights. In any event, the treaty which Jay had executed, and which had been, in fact, in part, a response to the Whiskey Rebellion, because the farmers couldn't get their bulk goods, downriver. Once they'd go down the Ohio and meet the Mississippi, it was now under Spanish control. The Dons had it. And so it was impossible for them to send any of their goods that way. They had a hard time sending them east to ports on the Atlantic coast, and so they turned it into whiskey. That's a whole nother discussion. But the treaty with Jay essentially came to an end in 1800 when Spain retroceded the territory, the Louisiana territory, back to France. And we were then permitted to continue to bring our goods to market, as we had since 1795, to bring it down to New Orleans. So, one of the fascinating aspects of this particular period of time is how intertwined all of these various events which take place from 1789 to 1815, 1816 are, and how they keep bumping up against each other and make for a very rich tapestry, a very complex tapestry, which many of our fellow citizens know very little about, if at all. And you can get into all kinds of details and get lost in the details, but the bottom line is that we won our independence in 1783. We confirmed it in 1814. And that's what the play really is all about. The last scene in the play is James Madison receiving the Treaty of Ghent in a lockbox, and he greets it almost as if he was greeting a child. And it was a very difficult birth, a very long birth, and he was delighted that he would receive this instrument and that he would then be able to redirect the country's energies towards development, towards movement westward, towards economic growth, and so forth.
Okay, thank you.